It's amazing, yeah. And because we're so conditioned to think linearly, aren't we? Like everything,
Oh, and three-dimensional.
yeah, and three-dimensional, linear and three,
Yeah. Every e-bit, it turns out, is four dimensions. Well, where is it then? So that's what's so spooky action at a distance about e-bits.
Can you explain that then?
Because it
Yeah,
cheats. Yeah,
entanglement,
see,
yeah.
so an entangled bit is where you take a single photon and you put it through this crystal and it generates a pair of lower energy photons that are in a specially way talking to each other. Okay, they're a combined set. So if you were to do this with coins, you would say, if I flip, these coins are in a special communications that anytime I flip either coin, the other one's going to be the opposite of it, no matter how far apart they are.
Right, yeah.
Okay, that's what's called entanglement. Okay, and so the thing is that you can have them light years apart, and instantly, if you flip one coin, the other one's going to be the opposite. And there's no local communications between them. And in fact, there can't be because they're a light year apart. So Einstein didn't like this. He called it spooky action at a distance, right? And but the reason it works is because it's a four-dimensional thing. It has this extra connection that you can't simulate in three dimensions. In fact, even Feynman says the best way to simulate a quantum system is to use a quantum system because you can't do it with a classical system.
Yeah, wow.
So this is tying all these ideas, obviously takes a little while to start getting your head, anybody's head around, which is why I had to write a 350-page book. It's elevator speech doesn't do it, right?
And
So.
also I think, like for me, Perkin, like I've been very passionate about this work for years now, and each year, as each year rolls by, I'm learning more and more about myself and realize I actually know nothing. And the more I learn, the more I actually don't know. And
Yeah, that's a good
yeah,
sign.
I guess. And I've had enough. I don't talk about it too often because I don't want to be other people's experiences, but I've had enough mystical experiences and enough even out of body experiences that have made me come back and go, wow, it's like I've got a new reference point. And from that new reference point, it
Yep.
allows me to come and then look at this information and the things that you're speaking about.
Yeah.
And it's like there's a part of my ego that's dissolved and disintegrated that's allowing me to really try and understand what's happening as opposed to just
Right.
shutting down before even hearing what you have to say, you
Right.
know. And
Yeah. So I have one more thing to add about the hyperdimensional
please.
definition. So once you have at least four dimensions, which you can't represent inside three-dimensional space, you just can't, right? It's the same problem with the flat land, right? So if you have, let's say, 100 e-bits, well, then you have 400 dimensions. Well, where do you put those 400 dimensions? When I say a dimension, I mean that mathematically they're not like bits stored in a three-dimensional space. They're actually their own independent dimensions, 400 dimensions that are orthogonal to each other. In other words, you have up, down, north, south, east, and west, and another 99 or 396 other dimensions that are other directions to go in.
Wow.
Okay, you can't simulate that in a lower dimensional space. So that's this quantum computer I'm talking about that is the infrastructure, and it's outside of space and it's outside of time. Why do I say that? It's because it has a kind of concurrency that precedes what we know about as time. So it's massively parallel, and in fact, it's big enough to simulate the entire universe in,
Wow.
which includes black holes, supernovas, atomic bombs. You know the difference between a simulator and a here's an example of how you can determine a simulator, right? If you have a simulation of an atomic bomb, you can do it all you want, do all the thing, but the computer doesn't melt. The simulation is independent of the computing
Yeah.
infrastructure, right? But if you have an actual atomic bomb, then the energy is released and it releases all this energy. Now you could simulate all that energy release, but it wouldn't melt the computer. Well, the same thing is true with the quantum physics world. You could have an atomic bomb and it doesn't melt the simulator that's running the atomic bomb in our physical world.
Yeah.
So I believe that we are running a simulator that's so powerful it can simulate nuclear events.
Yeah, wow.
And that's pretty powerful. And supernovas and black holes and everything else that we see in physics. So
as a science community and evolution of humanity, what are we doing with this information, and where can we take this as we learn more? Because if there's a subtle energy that's beyond space and time that's given rise to life, are we mm-hmm. able to tap into that? Are we able to bring that more into our lives? Are we able to then change
that's
the direction?
Back half of my book is like, if you understand this, you realize you can have mystical experiences, you know, it's not we're born, we live, we die, and that's the end of it. You know, we are eternal beings because these quantum dimensions have no space and no time in them. So if our mind is made of the same stuff, then it is eternal.
Yeah.
Right. And it has to be that way. We don't have to invent anything new for metaphysics, because quantum physics is powerful enough already to do everything we need to. We just have to talk about it in the right way. And once you do that, you can create predictions about other experiments that you can do. And that's what my co-author, Bill Tiller, did he had a lab for many years that he got funded to study interesting ways of looking at physics experiments. Okay. And so that's part of the story of the book, is making sure people understand what his contribution was to society. So
Does that make sense? Yeah, it does.